You said, friend, you may not know me now. This that would wait. You used to teach in Sunday school. I was only 8. Every week you would say a prayer before the class starts.
For 102 people to be in. They had very little food left when they arrived, and within weeks, nearly every single pilgrim was sick. Governor William Bradford was later recalled, and he, I quote, "That which was most sad and lamentable was that in 2 or 3 months' time, half of their company died." Like 50 people died in the winter. 50. Especially in January and February, being the depth of winter when hunting houses and other comforts being infected with scurvy and other diseases, there died sometimes 2 or 3 in one day. This is what they're going through. When spring came, the Indians showed them how to plant corn. That was a blessing. But their first crops were dismal. The supplies ran out. Their sponsors in London refused to send any more. The first time the pilgrims sent a shipment of goods to England, it didn't get there because pirates attacked the ship and stole what they sent back. If you had been there in 1621 with a year like that, would you declare a day to give thanks to God? That's what they did. If you had suffered through the famine, malnutrition, sickness, would you have felt grateful to God in spite of all the things that had gone through that year? And by the way, something I learned in studying about this again, Governor Bradford invented capitalism and free enterprise. I'll tell you why. When they first went, you know what they did? Communism, basically. They had a commune. It was a common farm. Common defense, common building houses. Everybody was in on it together. And when everybody is responsible for something, not everybody gets involved and does it. They'll let somebody work and other people are watching. And so what happened was in their communal attempt to start this new colony, it failed. And the next winter, they about starved to death again. They got down to 1 gram of grain a person a day the next winter. Communism wasn't working. By the beginning of the third year, they had decided that everybody would farm their own land, plant their own grain, everybody would be responsible to raise their own crops and provide for themselves and build their own house and maintain their own house. Yes, you could help each other, but it was kind of a martyr thing, and so everybody was doing it. So that meant all the kids, the adults, everybody was planting corn. They were all clearing ground. They were all building cabins. And you know what? They began to prosper by 1623.
Amen.
I don't think anybody puts that in the textbooks anymore, that they had to change their whole way of doing business. Here we've had all of us to deal with deaths in the church family. We've had church members who had to move to be near their children, and they've left us to be near their kids, and I hope it works out great for all of them. Some church members have had to deal with physical illness and are dealing with issues right now. Some people in our community have lost jobs. We're not the only ones. There's a whole bunch of people around us suffering that have all kinds of problems. And they're struggling. Folks, we do not experience problems alone in the family of humanity. Can we give thanks to God in spite of all the stuff that's going on? You look around this room. Every person you see in this room, is hurting in one way or another, either personally or because of friends and people they know and neighbors. Everybody has issues. Everybody. But can we still say, I'm going to give thanks to God without ceasing as long as I have breath? Yes. Yes. Never stop thanking God. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 says, rejoice evermore. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And I want to say, even when things aren't going our way, he says, rejoice evermore. Paul suffered from a very difficult problem. He called it a thorn in his flesh. He had been run out of town, beaten, whipped, stoned, imprisoned, betrayed, naked, cold, hungry, shipwrecked. He was stoned almost to death because of his faith in God. But he never stopped giving thanks. Romans 8:18, Paul wrote this. He said, for I reckon the sufferings of this present time aren't worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. He wrote this, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake, for when I'm weak, then am I strong. He said, when you should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. People are watching us. And when we go through the hard times and we keep on keeping on in the faith, no matter what, people are watching. And when we say, Jesus loves you, they say, I saw how you went through a hard time, but you kept the faith. Maybe you lost your job, and they say that you kept going to church and you kept worshiping God, and they say, I believe when you say Jesus loves me because you kept the faith. It's important for you and for me, no matter what we ever go through, ever, is to keep the faith and keep on keeping on and keep thanking God and keep having joy in spite of the circumstances that we go through, because we all go through circumstances in this life. Listen, you don't have to be thankful for your troubles. I'm not crazy. I would never say, oh gee, I lost my job. Isn't that wonderful? No. Or I got cancer, or I got a bad heart, or I got flat feet, or I got, fill in your blank. But you never stop giving thanks anyway. Because we remember who we belong to, who's holding us in his hand, who will never leave us alone, never forsake us. He doesn't leave us ever. We don't go through it alone.